At D-Wave, we have charted a course of aggressively pushing the frontier of quantum annealing processors and performance, and we continue to do this with our new quantum computer, the D-Wave 2X, the most advanced quantum computer in the world. Back in 2010, we released the D-Wave 1, which included a 128-qubit quantum annealing processor, which was realized in a truly scalable architecture. In 2013, we shipped the first D-Wave 2, which included a 512-qubit quantum annealing processor, which outperformed general-purpose optimization solvers and achieved performance on par with highly optimized heuristic solvers. Now in 2015, we have announced the D-Wave 2X, including a quantum annealing processor with over 1,000 qubits, as well as many technology improvements aimed at boosting quantum annealing performance. The new system runs at a colder operating temperature below 15 millikelvin, which helps the quantum annealing algorithm stay in low energy states and improve solution accuracy. Other improvements include increased control circuitry precision and a 50% reduction in qubit noise, which also combine to improve performance. With over 128,000 Josephson tunnel junctions, the new processors are believed to be the most complex superconductor integrated circuits ever successfully used in production systems. Our latest benchmarks on the D-Wave 2X show competitive performance against the best known highly tuned software solvers running on CPUs. On benchmarking problems, the D-Wave 2X finds near-optimal solutions up to 600 times faster than classical solvers if you compare the quantum processing time to the CPU time. The D-Wave 2X was recently installed at the Quantum Artificial Intelligence Lab at the NASA Ames Research Center in California. This lab supports research into machine learning and optimization by Google, NASA, and USRA member universities. Our new agreement enables Google and its partners to keep their D-Wave system at the state-of-the-art for up to 7 years, with new generations of D-Wave systems being installed at NASA Ames as they become available. The D-Wave 2X is the culmination of years of hard work, and we can't wait to see how this changes the landscape of computing.
I'm Jeremy Hilton. I'm the Vice President of Processor Development at D-Wave Systems. I'm responsible for the processor development group, which involves the design, test, and development and release of the quantum processor that D-Wave makes, which is the underpinning of the quantum computers that we build. Each of these black systems is a quantum computer. Inside that system is a thumbnail-sized quantum processor. In order to operate and develop quantum processors, we require a fairly extreme operating environment, which includes ultra-low temperatures and an ultra-low magnetic environment. And to achieve those, we need a fairly large and sophisticated system. The main room behind us houses the quantum processor, and the data racks in the front hold the quantum server, where users can access and program the quantum processor. And the other data racks include the cooling system, which includes pumps and is responsible for the chirping sound you can hear in the background. Inside the room, before we get to the quantum processor, there are many layers of shielding which allow us to create the low noise magnetic environment the chip sits in. If you look inside the data racks, you'll see that they don't contain what you would normally expect. So here we have some scroll pumps, which are mechanical parts associated with pulling vacuum on the fridge inside the room behind. So this is obviously highly unusual for a data rack, but has been integrated so that it wouldn't look out of place in a data center. And in fact, the requirements for running the system are consistent with all the services that would be available in a data center, which would include chilled water and power predominantly. In this rack is the quantum server, which allows users from anywhere in the world to interact with the processor itself. This server is receiving information from users, converting that into the machine language of the processor, and sending that machine language into the room behind, where high-precision analog electronics will convert those signals into electrical pulses, which are sent through cables into the refrigerator and down through the cooling system to the ultra-low temperature of the processor. It executes its problem, and then data from the processor is returned to the server and returned to the user. And the system is very flexible in that users can be programming in whatever language they're comfortable with and interacting with it either with this system in their data center or even here in D-Wave's lab. The quantum bits in our processor store information in the form of little magnetic fields. The 0 and 1 correspond to a little magnetic spin. The controls over the qubits are all in the form of magnetic fields. So the quantum processor is very sensitive to magnetic noise and the magnetic environment that it sits in. In order to keep that magnetic environment really low, as well as support the ultra-low temperature that it's operating at, this system behind me has about 16 layers of shielding between where I'm standing and where the chip sits at the center. These black panels are really for aesthetic purposes, and they integrate these data racks with a shielded room, which is the first of those layers of shielding, and is filtering out RF signals. So if you were to stand inside the room and close the door, your cell phone would stop receiving a signal. The fridge itself has a combination of radiation shields as well as magnetic shields, which help support the ultra-low temperature operating environment and achieve the ultra-low magnetic field. Inside the room, we have to keep electromagnetic noise very low. So even things like power outlets aren't allowed, because power can be quite noisy without extensive filtering. So inside the room, we have the cooling system, and these are radiation shields. So this is the next layer of shielding inside the room. The chip itself, the quantum processor, is sitting at the bottom of this array of shields. And this is, again, the first of several more layers. Inside these shields is vacuum, which is the insulation of the cooling system. When we want to swap the processor or conduct maintenance on the fridge, we warm the system up, we remove these shields, and then the processor is accessible, as well as all of the internals of the refrigerator.
My name is Murray Tom. I'm the Director of Professional Services at D-Wave. I talk with our customers and partners about what quantum computers are, what kind of problems that they solve, and work with them to develop software that uses quantum computers. We're standing inside a quantum computer. And you may know that the quantum world is delicate. It's easily disturbed. So there are many layers of shielding in this system, which we've removed in order to look at the internals here. A traditional supercomputer may have many thousands of processors in it, but in this quantum computer, there's only one chip located right down here. When you send an instruction to the quantum computer, a delicate quantum calculation is taking place on that chip to produce your solutions. The system we're looking at here is an ultra-low temperature cryogenic fridge. Because it works at such low temperature, we use the Kelvin scale to measure how cold it's getting. In the Kelvin scale, a warm room is like 300 Kelvin, and 0 Kelvin is the lowest temperature that can be reached. Physicists refer to it as absolute zero. There's two levels of cooling in this system. The top one is a pulse tube refrigerator, which takes us from 300 Kelvin to 50 Kelvin, and then down to 3 Kelvin. This is roughly the temperature of interstellar